friends. And thank you, ma'am, very much. And I must congratulate the medical education unit first, because what I gather from the presentation, in fact, it is encompassing the whole gamut of the medical education, starting from UG, post-graduation, senior residency, faculty, skill development, as well as the methods to develop various exit examination, as well as course modification. I think within this short period of time, despite your graphs, despite the COVID, I think that is a tremendous progress. And therefore, I will congratulate you that it's a good work. I'm convinced that it is a good work you are doing. It's a very helpful thing, right? Because I think we are getting away from one of the fundamental thing in medical education, that medical education somehow has becoming more in the process of skill development and technology and rapid progress in knowledge. The basic concept of becoming good doctors, what I call simple word, good doctors, somehow or other probably we are missing or taking away. If you see, that is reflected in the phenotypic phenomenon which you are facing. As doctors, we have two recognitions: peers, our peers, own people, own discipline people, and our patients. Now if you see, there is a phenomenon that we are losing trust with our patients. And one major thing in the trust is the communications. One major thing in the trust, we think if the patients are subjects, not human beings. You should see, go to the ward round, you'll see bed number 103, bed number 57, right? Bring the bed number 57 to OT. It may be good for identification. But you can say bed number 57, Sapan Mishra is the individual. Things like that. This is a mind perception. So I think a medical education unit which thinks laterally will combine the empathy, the human touch, the skill development, technology. Right. And that's the challenge. And that's actually today I see is the present day challenge, to amalgamate them and to provide a system where we can train our next generation doctors, right, much better than what probably we are doing today or had been doing in the past. We have gathered a lot of experience, and those wisdoms, if translated, will be full of benefits and gratifying result. Having said that, ma'am told me that to speak something on Teacher's Day, right? I thought about it. Then I thought, the Teacher's Day is being celebrated by everybody knows, by our President Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan's birthday. Why Teacher's Day? Because the man himself was a great teacher. He himself went to a Christian missionary school, I was just reading, and trained in Christian missionary school, where he found that there were challenges for Hinduism. And that enthused him to study Hinduism, to find out the negative aspect, and he became one of the greatest experts on Hindu scriptures and mythology and religions, on which he wrote volumes of books. And subsequently learned that all religions actually aims at one thing, started respecting all religion. But he had been a very popular teacher. He taught at Chennai, he taught at Kolkata Presidency College, and he's the first Indian to take a chair in Oxford University. And there is no doubt, on his birthday, we all celebrate Teacher's Day, and first thing I've written there, Happy Teacher's Day to all of you. You are great teachers. Now, question is, As teachers, we always think, and I've seen, that we blame our students. Ki aap padhai nahi karte ho, you don't read, you're neglecting, you're doing this. We never think that what we are doing. Are we teaching? Are we having passionate about teaching? Are we spending time to teach? And remember, is a undergraduate mind or postgraduate mind, very raw mind, which will accept things, or which will identify, or they will follow, they will follow. Each of us has a role model. I will tell you about my role models in the process. How I was influenced to become a physician, not a surgeon, not a pathologist, or become a doctor. Right. So this is a very important concept. So that's why this is very well known by Tolstoy. Right. If you want to be a Mahatma Gandhi has also told, if you want to bring in change, be the change yourself. And that's the first thing in a teacher. To bring in the change yourself, which will be able to influence your words. Right. And remember, I told you about two recognition. I didn't tell about a third recognition. Even those people who are teaching in medical institution are lucky people. I think they have an opportunity. I'm a retired teacher. I must have scores of students all around the globe, right, who idolize me. They think I am an icon, their hero, their role model. That is the third recognition. And that's a tremendous recognition. If you have not felt it, you will feel it if you do that in a passionate fashion. So you are in a unique position to have all the three forms of recognition. It's in your hand. Identify these people. First is very easy. First photograph. Your ex-president, Abdul Kalam. In an interview in Chennai, in his home, he was asked, you have become a big president, you have been a big scientist, you are behind our nuclear weapon. If you, now your presidency is over, will you like to be another again president to guide us? He told, no, I wanted to be a teacher. He told, why? Well, I have realized over this period, if I become a teacher, I can shape young minds, right, for a very successful, right, and enjoyable life, right, which I am missing. And he started the blog and internet services for innumerable young children and all around the country, and he moved around. A great teacher himself. Next is your very, very famous man. You know who he is, a great scientist, right? Who is he?
Einstein.
Now he was asked once in the interview, you become a Nobel laureate, you have become so much discoveries and credit to you. Are you not happy? What do you like to discover more? His answer was, I don't want to do anything except teach. Because I can create 1,000 Nobel laureates if I teach. And those 1,000 sciences will push the boundary of knowledge, which will help probably more than 1 billion people. And that's the crux of the teaching, which Einstein taught. If you see the next photo, there are two young fellows, Watson and Crick. When they grew up, they was, that's why I put their interview. They have been students when you were experimenting with this. Will you like to go back to lab and work? Till no. We want to teach, because we have realized if I teach and pass on the skills and knowledges which I have, it will multiply. The next man is two person, again two Nobel laureate, Barry Marshall and Warren, Helicobacter pylori. Their answer was same. The last one is a Barusa Blumberg, who found out hepatitis B surface antigen. Before death, 1 year before, he gave an interview writing. Right, which came in one of the hepatology journals, and I read it, I was very influenced. He said, it is not only your publications, your fame, nobody recognizes them, unless you have been successfully able to transmit the huge amount of knowledge and wisdom to a large number of people, right, at least if 10% of them will transfer that, translate that, your work, your effort has become successful. So do this last two young men who also got Nobel Prize. These are good people, good Nobel Prize winners. Allison's and Honjo. Checkpoint mutations. Immunotherapy today in all cancers. Right, anti-CTLA-4, anti-PD-1s. They are busy in their laboratory experiment. But after Nobel Prize won, they interviewed, they told 70% of our time we spend in teaching, 30% we spend in lab. Because unless I teach, and what I am doing I teach, my mind doesn't get clear. And that benefits me. These are different people. These are great achievers. Have achieved a lot. Each of them has realized later on, after their achievements, that it is the teaching which gives them pleasure, which gives them learning, which gives them ability to transfer the knowledge to innumerable to benefit mankind. So that's why I brought this photograph to see, because I read their interviews, and this is you. Right, I put it yourself to see these people and ask yourself always this question: why can't I imbibe 5% of their qualities and dedicate? And that will be probably maybe enough for us. Now, that's why I put this quote also. So this power is within you. And if you want, you can achieve. This is in general, but I thought this is very important to make you understand. There is a term called success. I don't like this term, personally. Probably most of us use success. I call it excel. Success is a term which is will tell by other people for about you. That ma'am is a very successful director, that's I tell. But see, her job is to excel in her job. She should not think I'm a successful director or I am a successful scientist. I have excelled in how to excel. Teaching is a profession and a very passionate profession. So the term, general term, is a successful teacher. Right. But have you ever thought, as medical college, you are giving didactic lecture? Have you been able to convert, identify the potential of students? There are, you see, we take students after entrance, we screen them. We pick them some of the brightest. Obviously, they have the brain. Somehow or other, education means, or training means, to expand their mind. Right. But what I see is sometimes, when they completed their training, their mind has something different. It has become more caged, narrow, tubular, one direction. Right. So I have asked this question, I will tell about this to myself. By education, are you actually in a formal method? That's why your medical education unit is very important. Are you constraining their mind or straitjacketing their mind? I'll give you an example. You know about Shakespeare. You know about Shakespearean languages. They're different. They're different than English languages. They're a great literature. He could express themselves in that colloquial language because he's habituated it. Think in class 6th or 5th, his father with a danda would have corrected him to do it in a proper fashion. He would not have a Shakespearean language. He left him free. There is a female, his name I am forgetting, Mary, first name is Mary. She is in the United States. She went to school. She was very restless. She was very fidgety. Was not concentrating on A, B, C, D or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, her class teacher, very initial classes, I am not exactly able to pinpoint, saw her and In those places, schools have psychiatrists. So she was concerned about that student. That's what I liked it. The teacher became concerned about that student and took her to the school psychiatrist. The psychiatrist saw him, thought, fine, there is nothing wrong with the child. He had a tape recorder with the music. He just switched on the music. The child started dancing. See, one had become one of the biggest ballet dancers in the world, who is a multi-billionaire today. The teacher saw the passion in her, identified the potential in her, and converted it to a full potential. So when you see in the school class, somebody is very good, somebody is not, in comparison to them, is good, according to your assessment, doesn't mean he is not less talented. In our profession, there are various skills. We can teach, we can do good research, we can be good clinician, we can be good medical administrators, good medical organizers. There are various kinds. So our job is to identify. And that's why I called it PSTR. It's a well-known term. Positive student-teacher relationship. That relationship has to be very positive. Because that will result in obvious things. You have a very cooperative student, they will like you, right? They will think this is their own. The belonging increases. The passion involvement increases. Anything which where you are involved, you see you are doing a wonderful job for medical education unit because you are involved. And the anxiety. I remember as an MBBS student, I don't know ma'am remembers or not, right? I always met anxious about exam performance. I personally don't think liked it. I think anxiety actually compromises in our output. So when you are anxious and examining a student, you are actually not being able to assess him actually freely. That's another thing. Motivation is very important, and creation of role models, which I emphasized. If you develop this positive student relationship, this is very good. And this is not mine. I see I have given you, this is a meta-analysis of 46 studies of teacher-student relationship. They have identified how students have been influenced, outcome measures, by their teachers to lead a successful career. And those students were not been influenced by the teacher. And they found these are 7 right signs. Obviously, these are standard things. Enthusiasm and passion, a very positive attitude, not negative, cynical. Achha, tum kuch nahi jaante ho, kisi jaanna tha, gada tha. You know, you have heard of this yourself many times from, that's not a right thing. So there has to be environment of comfort to make them train. And you must respect your word. I will give an example later on of my own. And second thing, teaching and learning are two different things. What you know, you speak to people. 1, 2, 3. Right? Bronchial breathing, 3C. Collapse, consolidation, cavity. Rectus. Right? Mug it. Don't give the concept. Why that bronchial breathing is like this? Right? So giving a fact is like bringing a computer printout. You have given facts, you want that printout to come. It is not giving the software, real thinking to, right? So that learning process will come if you are able to pass on this message. Well, the class is enjoyable, it's fun, you learn, right? It is entertaining. Those concept needs research, right? And therefore, your interest to students, not only in classroom, also outside, mentoring them is very important. And lastly, as Madam told, you gain. You always learn, not only with your subject, also in human behavior, shaping people, shaping minds. And those wisdom when you accrue gradually, it becomes great strength of your own. So the benefit is a win-win situation. That's what I think. And obviously this outcome measures with the students, with their better performance is very well known. I've given a term called hidden curriculum. That's what I was trying to say. This term is mine. You see, one of the very major reason, I've given six things. Intimidation of your wards. I'll give you an example. I went to do my fellowship in gastroenterology to All India Institute of Medical Sciences in Delhi. On first month itself, we have a radiology meeting every week we had with the gastroenterologist. Every patient's radiology will be done and that will be discussed with the radiologist. Now, I was the resident who used to present the cases. So the radiology professor put in a CT scan and told me, identify the problem. And that's the first time I was seeing a CT scan. Those days, that was in 1970s, CT scan had just come in. We had not seen a CT scan in the state where we were trained. I'd never seen it. I didn't know. But by that time, their CT scan was very prevalent. And she shouted on me, you're already asked, you don't know what is a CT scan also, you cannot say CT scan. That intimidation and that shame, that humiliation, right, prevented me to ask any question for coming 6 months. And I thought, I actually don't know. And that's a true fact. I was depressed. And that prevented me my performances in the clinical duties, in the calls, in regular OPD management, inpatient management, endoscopic intervention, or gastroenterologist, right? That compromised it. And my gradually, my reflex and my boss called me, well, what has happened to you? One event. Overcome. That's a very important. So, second is demand for a right answer. I don't know personally everything on the subject which I am studied over 45 years. Right? Probably there is a huge gap in the knowledge. I cannot provide right answer. I am a clinician, I see patient. Many patients ask me many questions. I cannot answer them. Because I don't know. I don't have the right answer. Or the answers are not there. So that's a very important thing. Right? And in the teaching, if you see, we have a little ego that I know. We never tell our student what we don't know. We never make their mind curious from the very beginning. We tell them, you have to know this, right? And this is the way it is. Knowing very well, things change. Right? So very important concept to tell what we don't know. And students, as I just pointed out, just like patients, this is a peculiar thing in medicine, what I've seen, we treat them as objects. Student, remember, student is like your own ward. Right? You have all, I'm a father. Right? Ma'am is a mother. Now, when our ward grows up, you remember we need care. They don't understand. We spend time with them. To the best of ability. And you don't expect always positive or right things. Right? So this is very important to understand. Right? And second thing, we make very unhealthy competitions sometimes, rather than teaching them healthy competitions. And that takes away the human touch actually. That is a very important to build up during undergraduate, and I think it's a unique opportunity. Another thing is, seniors are always right. Hierarchy is, boss is always right. In medicine, that should be. You should allow yourself to be questioned, to be pushed to the wall. Then only you will know. It's no harm saying, I don't know. I will come back tomorrow. I myself will do some research and study and will try to explain you. This is a very important thing. So your teachers also understand you are a human. right? And he can touch you. That's a very important thing. And we have seen big shot professors, right, who create aura. And I have been trained under such circumstances, right, in big institutes with people with big aura. They're great physicians, scientists. But I have put it because I never liked it. Because there's a perception which creates a big barrier between students. I was a student yesterday. I became a teacher next day. And that is the reason I learned that there should not be any barrier. Therefore, whatever position I had my always doors open for all students particularly and my young faculties. They can walk in at any time. There should not be any built perception that you are a big man, right? As a big shot professor, right? I think that is detrimental to yourself. As a young student, we criticize our big shot professors. I mean, that's a very practical thing. I'm telling you what I have felt, okay? So I don't want to say this, I'll just discuss, right? This emotion plays a very crucial part. That's what I wanted to say, right? It helps in retention, it helps in learning, it helps in conceptualization, and it also helps in future behavior of learning. And two important components of as a physician or a doctor, empathy and compassion, which I want to be amalgamated to the whole advancement which you have today. I was telling you. So what I told, three things. Positive student-teacher relationship first, hidden curriculum second. In the process, I've spoken many words, but these are two important things I've. Third thing, mentoring young mind. This is the third point which I. Very important. I will give you a simple example because the best example is your own experience. As a young kid, I grew up in a village with my grandfather's parents. And my grandfather was not a very educated man. He was a priest. And my grandmother has never gone to school. And I used to never go to school. I used to pluck in all exams. I remember since class 3 or class 4. Before that, I don't remember. But then also I used to, right, fail in multiple subjects. You understand Odia also, no? All of you? So, mathematics or Ankaramugra 300 out of 100, 4, 5, this was my mark. Right? My grandfather had a stroke. And in that whole area there is one doctor. So I will hold my grandfather, I used to love him so much. Take him to that doctor. There will be hundreds of people sitting there. And I used to strongly believe that doctor will give a potion which was Osoddhava, my grandfather will walk. Right. The trust. I'll tell you about that. That I learned later on as a doctor. My grandfather, while returning, will tell me, son, will you not read? If you read, you become a doctor like this and help so many people, will come back with a smile on their face. He never didn't scold me. Never scolded me for class, failing in the classes, keeping 5 or 6. He persuaded me. Will you not become a doctor, will help. As a young kid, that impressed me. You understand? About a month after that, because I grew up little what? Not a year or two, I just don't remember that. My father, who was an engineer by then, I was staying, used to stay in Delhi, told my grandfather that he must go to a good school. He shifted to a suburban town nearby. So he shifted. When he shifted, we left that village thatched house. And 2 days before leaving, my grandmother was putting a sapling. So I was disgusted. Why are you putting this? You are leaving this. So she called me. son, when you came to this house, there are mango trees. In Orissa, you know the berry trees, borokoli. You know guava trees, pijuli. These are usual. These trees are there. You have been going and eating them. I didn't plant them. Somebody else has planted them. You liked it. You enjoyed it. You benefited somebody. He benefited somebody. So what is there? We have been benefited so much. Well, okay. And then she told me, see, this is important. Your grandfather is telling you to study. If you become a doctor, that's why I'm a doctor actually. If you become a doctor, you'll benefit so many people. Uneducated lady, uneducated old man, understood my mind and persuaded my mind. And today I become a doctor. You understand? I went to MBBS, right? I went to MKCG Medical College, undergraduate. I was a good sportsman. By that time I was playing for my state, for soccer. Also, I used to play a lot of, badminton and table tennis. I used to captain in university also. So I will, again, after getting medical college, I thought I have got in medicine. Right? The doctor to bani jaunga, doctor to was, hey, you don't need it. I started bunking anatomy classes. They are very boring. And we have a professor called K.S. Rao. I don't know, you people are young. He is teacher of many of us. I never forgetting him. Always giving them a tremendous regard and respect from my inner core of heart. His job is, in the next class he will come and call student by roll number, not by roll number, by name, first name. Never calls a student by roll number. Acharya Subrat Kumar, yes sir. Right? Just like that. And for 5 minutes he will ask questions on the previous class, what he had taught. And he can identify boys who have not read it, because they will be hiding behind the two other students. You know that, you have done all that. And I was the first man to do that, in the back. He will make me stand always, ask question I cannot answer. He will never say anything. After 3 classes, he told me, come to my room after the classes. By 5 p.m. classes are over, I went to his room. He told me, why you are not reading? I am putting so much of effort. All other students are doing. Actually, he used to put up a lot of effort. Very hard effort. So I told him, sir, I don't have book. I lied to him. Lied to him. Why? You don't take notes because I cannot write well. So why can't buy a book? Because I'm very poor, sir. I don't have money. I was a little nutty. He gave me a Gray's Anatomy from his Almira. Take this book. No way to get away. Then also I didn't read. Then after 15 days he called to me his room at 4 p.m. I'll sit there up to 6 p.m. and read the chapter. He'll ask a question, I'll answer him back. How much personal involvement? Identify a fellow. And today I'm a product in front of you. Understand why I gave these examples. Professor Harbakulaji, on Sunday he will come. For 3 hours, he will teach us on Sundays. Every Sunday, he will take an additional class and teach us pharmacology outside the syllabus. In fact, from him, first I knew about animal experiments as an undergraduate kid. Right? I'm giving you a few examples who is imprinted in my mind. Tell me, do you have a better recognition than this for these 3 teachers? Today I am remembering them, giving them my heartfelt regards, telling you people about them, Do you think more recognition is necessary, more than this? And that's the importance of a teacher. Right? I became a teacher. And these things, you remember, this influences me. If you ask my fellows whom I have trained, you'll be surprised. They don't think me as a teacher. They call me, I'm their mentor. So that's the advantage of graduating from a teacher to a mentor. Another important thing which I want to, after I have to pass the MBBS, obviously we all go for specialization entrance test, isn't it? I was thinking, I saw how your behavior affects. I saw a surgeon in the OT, very irritated fellow. He'll throw scalpel like this. What is this? You know, what a subject. He's only throwing scalpel and sewing tantrum. What is this? But I was walking on the street, I saw our professor of medicine, Suresh Mishra, Margaret, died. He settled down in Sambalpur. Smiling always, patient come from the back and told him, sir, can you see this chest x-ray? Saw below this tree. There was a young kid, remember. Asked him to question and gave him a prescription that read roadside. I was very impressed. I'm like, kya doctor hai? Ped ke neche x-ray dekh ke dawai de deta. Yehi subject karna hai mujhe. I took up medicine. I became a physician. So that's a very important thing. Without your knowledge, how you influence your students. Remember, that is true for your children. It's equally true for your children. Very important, right? Subsequently, these are few names I have never forgotten. These are great people who taught me, guided me, held my hand, did hundreds of mistakes with them. Hundreds. Each has a story. I can write story on each of them. But each time these people made me learn, right, always persuaded, never criticized me, always told me, you have great talent, always propelled me to do better by identifying my talents in me. Not by criticizing, by persuading, by spending time with me. And I could see that they think about it. That's the teacher. Now, he always used to take me, I am here, right, with me to all his meetings and will make me sit, ask me questions. I am here with him. This is the Professor Tarnad, right? He cannot identify as a very young man. This is me, right? This is me, and this is my boss, who used to take me to all the meetings. That's why I showed you this. This is another thing, fourth thing. So I told you first thing what I told you, positive student-teacher relations. Second thing I told you, hidden curriculum. Third thing I told you, persuasion of young mind, mentoring a student. This is the fifth. Okay? Arrogance. This is a very interesting story. I'm not giving you the story. There is a university in US called Carnegie Mellon University. Randy Paus was a professor of computer science there. He used to get frustrated because the students are no more interested in science and technology. They are going to Wall Street. You have heard about Wall Street? Dalal Street, share market. Right. So, all students are going for economics to go to Wall Street. So, he used to get frustrated and in the evening will go back and sit in a small bar, have a beer. And another man will come to see, sit there regularly. They didn't know each other, but one day they talk. The other man's name is Arnold Seibold. So they introduce themselves. Sewall told, I am the chief executive of Times magazine. I am an artist of advertisement. So he was also have similar feeling. And Randy told him, look, can you do something? Can you combine computer science with art to make teaching interesting? They joined head, they created Electronic Arts, which your computer game all over, and all your children's educations. That is called EA. It's a big subject in Carnegie Mellon. They made billions. Randy Poss was invited to go a lecture because Carnegie Mellon thought every month they will have a lecture by a senior faculty to enthuse student to do well. And he was the first man to be selected to talk. He gave the name last lecture. The reason is he had pancreatic cancer with Mets in her liver. He told that, this is not the first lecture, this is my last lecture. But in the process he described his childhood dreams and how he grew up. One thing he told was the arrogance. One year, an initial year, that is sophomore years in U.S. See, his professor, his name was Andy Van Dams. His first meet with his professor, see the teacher, first year student. He put his arm around my shoulders. He writes, this is a book, last lecture, read it. And we went for a little walk and he said, Randy, it is such a shame that people perceive you as so arrogant. वो आते आते पहले दिखाना था उसका नखरा दिखाया. बिकॉज इट इज गोइंग टू लिमिट वॉट यू आर गोइंग टू बी एबल टू अकम्प्लिश इन लाइफ. वॉट अ हेल ऑफ द वर्ड टू वॉट अ हेल ऑफ अ वे टू वर्ड यू आर बीइंग अ जर्क. राइट, ही डजंट से यू आर अ जर्क. ही सेज पीपल आर परसीविंग यू दिस वे एंड ही सेज द डाउनसाइज इट is going to limit what you are going to be able to accomplish. This I gave you a particular statement because Randy told it in a very wonderful way, that his arrogance vanished. And his professor identified it. That's the important thing. And how he explained it. Okay, look, perceived you as a jerk. It's not so that. What they perceive that you are talented, but you will not be able to accomplish what is could when I succeed to accomplish. That's the important. So this is the fourth important as a teacher. I was a little hot-headed fellow. This is a young faculty, Vineet Ahuja. He's a professor of gastroenterology at Ames, one of the most brightest student I ever had. Internationally famous for inflammatory bowel diseases, a lot of work. As a young student, he told me, sir, you are arrogant. Well, why? He said, you are very egoistic and eccentric and arrogant fellow. You cannot even talk to a girl. You cannot charm a girl. It's a fundamental thing. She showed me his photograph. Well, yes, you are right. Right. I must say, I learned from him. Then I went back after 2 years and showed him this photograph. Look. Right. I've learned from you. That's what I'm in a lighter sense I want to point and make it a very important point. Right? So I became a doctor. I became a gastroenterologist. And now I think that was the beginning. And most important thing I learned from my patient over a long period of time, that I don't know. Medicine is humbling. It brings you down to earth. And it also told me that knowledge is not compartmentalized. Because I am a gastroenterologist, I did not know cardiology or mathematics is wrong. Lot of inputs make you a better teacher, better researcher, better clinician. Right? And that makes you identify the gap in knowledge which you have. That is very important for a teacher. To pass on to your student is very important. That's what I felt, I'm telling you this. And this is the fifth important thing. I joined as a faculty. I was the youngest faculty. I used to take all calls, all interventions. I didn't know what to do, lot of work. But I will do myself everything. Right? I thought I'm inadequate at that level. My confidence was settled. I went to for a fellowship. He exposed to me a lot of things, transplant, laboratory, all the molecular technology. And again there I started doing same thing. I will go to the transplant retrieval, I will go for the transplant management, I will go for the transplant clinic, I will go to the lab to do PCR, I will go for the ELISA, right, I will go for endoscopy to do ERCP. He called me. Subrat, you cannot do everything. You have to have a team. Medical science is a team, not individualist as you think today. That's why I kept these slides today. There is another very important thing. This is the form of arrogance. So fifth thing what I am trying to tell you, the arrogance. There are various ways you manifest it. Right? So, this I have told you, that relationship. I don't want to discuss about structured approach and education, I told. I don't want to tell about integrated curriculum. But one thing I want you people to teach students, that medical science is an art on the saddle of science. Remember, that is not told by me. This I saw Sir William Osler way back in 82. And see his statement, prolific. If it were not for the great variability among individuals, medicine might be as well a science and not an art. And therefore, it is very art, and therefore we take Hippocratic oath, primum non nocere. If you cannot do good, do not do harm. And that is the medical art, which is a very important concept to train students from the beginning. The science is the evidence. Art is ability to use the evidence. And that's why our discipline is unique, right, if you combine both of them. And that's the impart knowledge, what I think. And we have all these three areas, you remember, education, research, clinic. This is another area to impart every doctor. Because many clinicians practice in their home, in their private clinic. They treat hundreds. They think they are doing right. But out of 100, 30 doesn't get cured. 70 gets cured. So unless they are able to have the records and analyze this patient, the 101 patient will never be treated better. This information has to go in as a teacher. And each time when you teach, try to improve. This is a Japanese word, kaijin, change for good. You raise your arm, do a little more next time. But don't use same slides. Change them. So, friends, I don't want to go into all this, right? I think the goal of medical education, not only to produce graduates, to produce compassionate medical graduates. Make them learn about team approach, not individualistic, which I'm seeing, which is recreating lack of trust. And quality relations with patient as well as community, with competence, what I summarized. Are you doing that? Is there a disconnect? As I told about Shakespeare's, about that Lady Mary, are you not able to identify? Right? Because of lack of a PSTR, positive student-teacher relationship, or a hidden curriculum, or a arrogance, something. Right. There are many studies now that a formal education is resulting in erosion of skills, attitude during their medical curriculum. Right? Not told by me, not told by a gentleman. I wish I have been able to pass out some message to you from my own experience. Right? What I think is right. I hope it will help you. But I must convey my deep gratitude that you allowed me to speak to all of you. Right? Well, I am amongst one of you. I am just like another faculty at AIIMS. Unfortunately, I am old. I was born earlier than all of you, right? But I always consider till my in my heart that actually given me another opportunity while we are teacher. Thank you very much.